Well, heidi ho, and welcome back, everybody, here to the D2CL coverage, our final game of the day here on the joinDOTA Red livestream. As we are going in to our third match, is 1-1. Everything's locked up, so it all comes down to this matchup. Who will face up against LGD in the consolation final tomorrow at 10 CEST? Which, by the way, will be cast by myself as well as Syndrin. Already locked in and confirmed. That game will be happening nice and early. But we'll find out who's going to get there. I am joined by the wonderful man who's been definitely helping us through tonight to understand the world, the universe, and everything, and that is from Team Alliance, fucking mad, or I like to call him, Sebastian.
Sebastian, that works too, that fixes all the spelling mistakes, yeah. Right? So yeah, I'm glad to be here again for that game 3, looking forward to that one. It's 1-1, it's tied for now. I think both teams played really well through the whole series. It's very nice to see. We had a lot of different heroes played. We saw some Abaddon, some Morphling, some Nyx, some Darks here. It was quite nice. Let's hope for interesting drafts and a really nice last game.
5 seconds. Yeah. I'm almost hoping we get a game which is closer to game number one. Well, I know there's a lot of accidents, mistakes that ended up happening there. I felt more like the draft, there was more for the teams to work with. In the last game, I know we were both probably sitting there around the 10-15 minute mark going,
That's always the weird thing about Dota, you know.
It feels over.
It's what's really weird about Dota, and you don't really know what you want to what you want to get, because when the games are actually of a higher level and played with less mistakes, then the game is a bit more boring, I'd say. Because the team that's in control, just they don't give away their advantage, and they actually win when they are supposed to win. And the first game, we saw a lot of back and forth action because of the mistakes that were done. Burning did some crucial mistakes. Then they had this smoke into a three-man axe call that actually lost them the fight really hard, and stuff like this. But yeah, for the last game, I mean, I think there's always that, you know, decisive game magic.
Oh.
Where?
Oh, we have a remake. We have a remake.
We do? Yeah, that was a really long ban, actually.
Yeah, that's why I was just like, this isn't right. There's something is awry.
Oh, indeed.
Yeah. there's no way they're using this much time on the extra time. That cannot be correct. So I just checked the chat.
Why did they remake? Do you know?
The picks were the wrong way around, I believe.
Okay.
I was reading something BP. So I'm like, I'm gonna assume it's bad pick or something like
something
that.
Something is as if like Chinese characters, right?
Yes. Okay. Well, it's.
How's your Chinese not fluent yet, Toby?
Well, you know what? I try to study at different karaoke bars.
okay.
But it's really difficult.
Yeah,
and
it is.
I'm just going la 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 the entire time. Yeah.
I guess that doesn't work. And then, oh no, they paused. What is going on? Arrow TKE? Yeah, we're good to go.
Everyone's in, everything's fine. So, we start our draft.
Okay.
We'll get back into it. So,
fair enough.
Yeah.
Let's see.
Nothing wrong. And we already know what
we're
drafting.
Yeah, they actually. Invictus, they changed sides, right? I'm pretty sure they changed sides. IG was Dire before the remake, and now EHOME is Dire.
No. Yes.
I think so.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. All right. Yes. 100%. Looked over to my side screen, and EHOME is sitting on the Radiant side on there, and now they're on the Dire side. You're 100% right.
So they switch. They switch sides. Fair enough. Probably some Torrent Course thing. Again, the Storm ban, the Respect ban versus Ferrari. I think every team went for that ban. Even the European teams, when they went to the major All Stars tournament, they were banning the Ferrari Storm, so fair enough. I mean, when you see how he dominates the lanes, he had really good matchups, though, in both games, honestly. They just...
His two most played heroes, in fact, have just been Sniper and Storm.
Okay,
Interesting that they are the first two being banned out here.
Yeah, a lot of respect coming toward that player. Honestly, that player is a beast. Like, he's been so stable over the years, and he keeps on crushing the mid lane and more than the mid lane.
Has there been any TI that he hasn't attended? I think he's been in every TI.
Yeah, that guy is impressive. He's still playing mid. He's playing with the same team. He's playing as good. I don't think any core player is that, like, as stable, honestly. That, like, Ferrari 430, he's been around forever and he's performing at the highest level.
I love the thing, you only just touched on it, but I just want to flag this right now. IG hasn't played for any other team apart from, Ferrari hasn't played for any other team apart from IG.
Yeah, he's like the...
That's it, like, he's the equivalent of what Dendy would then be.
Gaming's yeah.
Like, the person, like, has there actually been any other player in China that hasn't switched a team?
I think Dendy and Ferrari are very close. Like, their style is very close. Like, they're very, you know, mechanical players. They're very good at playing their lane. They've been around forever. They play with they're very loyal players, very respectful guys. Yeah, they're like similar one to another. And the Wisp is not banned or picked for now. They first picked the Batrider. And the SF on Raiden, it's funny, it's a revert draft from the last game. Last game it was IG on the Dire first pick, and they first pick Bat, and EHOME went for SF plus Lion, and this time around it's the opposite.
Were you hoping to see the Wisp?
Yeah, I'd like to see a Wisp.
Lion.
Yeah, I'd love to, and now Lion, it's the exact same. I'd love to see a Wisp from EHOME. I don't know if they play the Wisp, actually, I'm not sure.
I don't have anything from EHOME. I have it from IG. That was actually that CDEC game they won with a Wisp Tiny. They used two different push strats. They ran Wisp Tiny in one game, and they won with a Pugna Shaman in the next game.
I think Batrider Wisp is a very very, very, very scary combo to have. It would be a shame not to pick it up, but they probably practiced something else, and then they don't want to go for it, which is fine.
What's the Batrider Wisp combo you're searching for? Like, how's it work?
It's... I mean, Batrider is a really good hero to set up for relocates, right? He can just run around the map, just blink glass with some guy, then you get the relocate. It's very scary to play around this because it's already, against it. It's already scary to play versus a bat.
Do you not care the combination hero with the Wisp, or is it just like...
Yeah, it doesn't matter. You can get anything. It's just that when you play against it, it's really scary to go out on the map alone by yourself. It's already scary versus a bat, but there can be three heroes just... getting on you and you're disabled, so even if you run around with two and even three, it's risky, so you just get that map control advantage just because you have bat plus relocate ready. So it's always good when you have Wisp, you want to have at least one hero that can actually initiate a gank just to set up for that relocate and use that global presence. So Batrider does the job, Clockwork does the job, I don't know, Legion Commander, any fight opener can do the job, but Batrider is obviously one of the best fight openers. Batrider plus Silencer combo, that's a C9 opening here. Very strong, very very strong. The lasso into the global, like, they can't take the fight, they're just gonna have to give away a kill, because if they start running and try to save the guy, then you're gonna use global and you're gonna win the follow-up fight. Very scary combo to play against.
I'm interested to see if EHOME are going to do the same as what they've done previously. This could have been the time when I go, man, prediction time is going to be an Ursa for EHOME.
Ursa?
The last time they picked up a silencer, they ran it in a combination with Ursa.
Okay.
It was a little bit more focused, though, because they're going up against a Queen of Pain as well as a Bristleback.
Okay.
So they felt the power of the silencer and the Ursa then.
Yeah, that could actually make sense. I mean, maybe Ursa is not bad versus Bristol. It could be right. It could be right.
But
very good.
But IGF haven't picked it up yet, so I'm not going to say 100% they're going to pick up Ursa. It's just Invictus something to note and keep in mind that right. EHOME have been known to do that. They only did it once, but they were known to do it once.
Fair enough. I think the Wisp is still a good option for EHOME, even with that silencer pickup. You can dual lane mid with the Wisp, and then you have that silencer remaining. Support safe lane. He's really strong, he can force back any offlaner.
5 seconds remaining.
The Glaives, not messing up the lane aggro, that's a really good thing to force back the offlaners, and then he just has a lot of damage. I don't think any offlaner can actually trade hit. I really like that silencer support in a 2v1 situation. I think he's really strong. So Viper pick, they're banning a lot of mid heroes. So I don't know. I mean, they have Ferrari's mid hero already. That's why you can see how IG plays. You know, you have those teams, and you know every team has a centric player. I don't know how to put it, but it's like IG, they definitely play around Ferrari the most. Like, they first pick his hero, they ban the counters. You know, they play around him a lot. They have a lot of strategies around Ferrari for sure.
That's that Brusselback we're talking about.
Yeah, I mean, if they want to go for that Ursa, maybe it's a bit better now that they have the Bristol. But yeah, I think EHOME didn't reveal anything, and that's what's very interesting about the draft right now. I mean, obviously they have only two heroes picked, but even with those two heroes, they didn't reveal much. Whereas IG, you show that SF, you know it's an SF mid.
Yeah.
Like, you know already they want to focus on the mid lane, they want to get a strong safe lane, blah blah blah. Whereas EHOME, they can do whatever. Reserve
time. Yeah, they're pretty flexible. Even with the silencer, we can go back to Team Empire days of 12 months ago, where you ran aggro silencers and you just started stealing intelligence for everyone because you found kill after kill after kill after kill. And it's so effective up against heroes that have very high mana cost abilities too. Normally, your safe lane call has got that. Okay, you're actually picking a Brewmaster into a silencer. I'm giving IG a lot of confidence here. It will probably. Well, wait, is this now turning into a Ferrari, a Burning Brew?
Yeah, I think it is. I think it is 100%. I think a Brewmaster offlane versus a silencer is gonna have
death.
The toughest game ever.
Yeah.
Like he's not gonna get anything.
It's gonna be a Brewmaster and Burning anyway because Luo hasn't been playing the Brewmaster on the offlane. It has been Burning picking up the Brew.
Good for them. Good for them because else I think it would have been a big mistake. But so it's gonna be a Brew safe lane. So that lineup, that Brew Bristol SF is a lineup we see a lot. I mean, we see a lot of Bristol SF and we see a lot of Brew SF. So why not the triple heroes? But it's a very heavy team fight oriented. Like, they have a lot of disables, a lot of sustain, a lot of damage, a lot of pushing power. It's super scary to fight versus this. Honestly, this lineup is so scary to fight. And whenever you see, at least in Europe, right? I don't really know how the drafting in the eastern part of the world works right now because I didn't have to focus and study it, but I know that in Europe, when you first face SF, you're most likely going to see a Brew ban or a Bristle ban. Bristle ban for sure. And that's mainly because of Secret. But now they get the Brew, they get the Bristle, they get the dream lineup for a lot of European teams. So let's see how EHOME actually deal with that. I don't like the Templar pick so much. They want to dominate mid lane, which is fine. And I do agree that Templar does quite well 1-on-1 versus SF, but the problem for that Templar is that the first fights are going to be really hard. Templar is going to go into very tanky heroes that you can't burst down. Even during the silence, you're not going to kill the Brew, you're not going to kill the Bristle, you're not going to kill the SF. It's probably a mech SF, you know, it's going to be those lineups where they go Vanguard.
Yeah,
on Bristle, mech on SF, and they just push.
But at the same time, right? If this Ursa pickup is coming from EHOME, and you're running a Templar Assassin, your first fight's going to be one with an Aegis the Immortal in your hands.
Yeah, that could be huge, actually. If they can have the Aegis advantage, that Templar pick is good for that. That's a very good point, actually. The Templar can give them an early Roche, and then they can take those fights, and it could be a way to actually push them back or trade even with IG when they first push. And that's a good thing, but I feel like right now they lack a lot of. Their team fight is just not on par with IG's. IG's team fight is insanely strong.
Oh man,
it's so hard.
When you go to Dazzle, keep everyone alive. You've already got the armor balance from that. The Brewmaster, Chaos Factor, Bristle Back, use the Space Creator, Lights, your burst damage, and also Initiator. And
it's
the
so
Shadow
scary.
Fiend, Requiem of Souls, and burst damage. Yeah, I'm with you. IG looks really, really scary. And EHOME, I almost feel like they have to force the issue before it's time. Like, run Juggernaut, Silencer, Witch Doctor, aggro lane, leave TA in mid, and put Batrider on the safe lane. Just so they can get on top of things before it even starts.
The problem with that is the Brew Dazzle safe lane is actually quite strong. I mean, I know line is a bit weak, but those heroes, they're not afraid of triple aggro. I mean, I don't know. I think first game, EHOME had a really good draft, and to me at least, it looks like this game 2, game 3, IG definitely had the advantage with the draft. They definitely dominated EHOME in that phase of the game, at least. So right now, EHOME have an okay draft. It's a good one, but they need to utilize the space they're given as much as they can. Like, they, before IG pushes, they need to trade towers, they need to get a lot of farm on the Juggernaut. He needs to farm, and then they need to take the fights they can take, like get Rosh whenever they can. Let's say when IG goes for the top part of the map, the towers, they get Rosh, and then they keep on farming, and then they defend battle when they can, and maybe they can, of course they can win the game as well, but I think it's a bit scary. And if they play the way they played last game, where they just, they're not sure if they want to defend or not, and they waste time on their farmers, then I think IG is gonna, they can just run over them.
Well, let's see what happens as we're gonna get ourselves underway. Let's get a little bit of bearings for the lane. So down the bottom lane, it will be ROTK moving very quick in as that Batrider leave one ward behind. Chuan, he's only moving out here with boots to see where these wards are being placed, but we've got both Observer and Sentry that's already been planted down, and Sentry and Obs coming out from Chuan. So I kind of want to watch and wait and see where he's going to throw down his own Sentry. Burning will be running that Brewmaster as the safe lane. In towards the mid, Ferrari 430, Shadow Fiend, clap twice if you're surprised, which means you should not be going anywhere near your other hand. Faith will be the Dazzle, supporting up. And where did he throw the Sentry? He got rid of the Observer, but not in range for the other Sentry.
That's quite big, actually, for them, because the second Sentry is... it's on the Bristle, so they're not going to T-ward bottom. So they're going to block the pull, which is a really good news for EHOME. That's already an advantage they're getting. They could dual lane, off lane RG. Are they looking at... No, they're not. But it's okay. Silencer is going to force them back anyway. Now they're blocking again. Oh, but he just placed a Sentry under another Sentry, so they're going to T-ward this. Right. And now...
I'm just going to work through the remaining lanes as well, because I've started something and now become a little bit ADD about it all. Flame's going to be a Templar Assassin, the mid DDC supporting. They're actually got the duel in the mid, so Ferrari and Faith are going to be together here in the mid, so DDC trying to help get the early advantage. And then Leisure safe lane, Lanham supporting, Luo's the off lane, Bristleback, and WC, he's the last one, who's up on top.
Yeah, it's good prediction from DDC. He knew that the Dazzle would try to help the SF get the first soul, so that he just stands on the lane as well and harass them back. Faith went for the Poison Touch first, which is the TA, which is okay.
I'm interested to see the DDC does this with the Glaives. While we got ourselves a pause and we've stopped this, I remember, for me, I always take a lot of silencer builds back to what Team Empire used to run, because they ran it before the Glaive change came in. Is it really worth getting Glaive at the very, very start, instead of trying to force something like Curse the Silent out and then slowly just burning away at the enemy?
Yeah, I mean, now that he sees that SF went for Necromastery, maybe Curse was a decent choice, but the SF can also wait for the Silencer to reveal his spell and then get raised, right? Because if he curses and then SF just raises, and then the curse doesn't do so much. I think Glaive is okay. The fact that it doesn't aggro the creeps is what makes that silencer so good on the lanes. It just makes his harass way stronger, and there's nothing Faith can do about it. Now their positioning is really nice mid lane, like they're both uphill, so Inflame and DDC are missing a lot of hits. So Ferrari's gonna do okay, but personally I like the Glaives first on silencer. I think I prefer it. The curse of the silent. It depends on the lanes. If obviously you have heroes against you that can't really cast spells, or it costs them a lot of mana, then it's worth it. But in that case, I think Glaives is fine.
Alright, well. I'm happy I got my question answered. I'm also very happy the IG players get to come back into the game.
Yeah, that's nice.
Yeah. No long delays. No, none of this attack business.
Yeah, it's good. It's been a smooth theory so far, so that's good.
Yeah. There was actually something that Durka was laughing about before, where he's like, I'm really enjoying casting Chinese Dota of late, because everything's on time, and there's no massive amounts of pauses.
Yeah,
it's like, oh, it's, really? Yeah, is it really that great?
Matches has been such a mess.
How's that European? Well, I've got a two-hour pause in one of the games.
Gosh, yeah, even yesterday, honestly, there was a C9 game versus Empire, and the Empire players, they had to play their elimination match at 3 a.m. Moscow time.
Really?
Yeah, I guess that's
what competition was this for?
It was the summit. So, yeah, it was quite unfortunate for them. And now they're out. And it's always hard to say. Obviously, the winners, they didn't steal away the win. They won, right? And they played well to win the game. But when you play games at 3 a.m., after an hour of pause, maybe more, 2 hours of pause of discussions, and you're exhausted and you're annoyed, then I'm pretty sure you lose a bit of focus and you gotta be frustrated with it, but whatever. It's part of the game and it happened to others before, and one day it will disappear completely and we're all gonna get it, like, be very happy about it, but so far you have to deal with it.
Oh, I can't wait until we're gonna release this article on joinDOTA and see what people say about that, because we, I'm writing something currently with Gorgon, and we talk about the current issue at hand.
Yeah, there are issues that needs to be, you know, like, kind of.
The funny thing is, if people listen to some of the discussions I was having, if you were listening to my other game I possibly cast, which everyone's been trolling inside the channel for a while, to the PGL live stream when I was doing my CSGO stuff, we actually had a long discussion with a guy called Khan from Fnatic about this and kind of stuff which happens in other scenes which doesn't happen in Dota 2. I want to wait until the article comes out before we can expand on that one, but definitely keep your eyes peeled for that. It's an issue which has to be addressed.
Yeah, exactly, and it's a discussion which has to be open, and definitely. I'm looking forward for this.
Opens the keyword, because there's a lot of times when you knee-jerk reaction everything which you think is just trying to say that you're doing something wrong, but it's not that. We're just trying to utilize what we do have so we can do things better.
Exactly, yeah. And I think we all want to work toward the same goal anyway, so I don't think, you know, people overreact, but at the end of the day, we all want to get those problems fixed. So that's the priority of everyone, and then I'm pretty sure everyone can agree on the same solution.
Yeah. It's all for the greater good.
So now we lost a lot of players.
No, they're just jumping in and out. Players were saying their ping is 100 is perfect. And the IG guys, they just do what I was doing before. I disconnected, reconnected back in again, all of a sudden the ping works well.
It's good that they write their sentence in Chinese signs and the other half in, something we can understand. So it's like something, something ping, something, something 200. You're like, okay, I understand Chinese, man, it's fine.
Yeah, I'm assuming ping okay means the ping is okay.
Might
be before it is the next phrase coming after this will be completely sarcastic. Oh, ping okay.
And then Sean just wrote something that we can understand. Yeah, they're jumping in and out, as you said. They're probably trying to fix their...
Wasn't there an interview with Sean recently where he actually refused to speak English on the stage? I think it was at the Malaysian All-Star.
Oh, did he? Did he say I won't speak English or what?
No, he just didn't speak it.
He does speak English.
Oh, he does, but he was just a way. Oh no, was that no? That wasn't it. That wasn't it. It was somewhere else, and it wasn't him. But it was. So my story is completely irrelevant for all the players inside this game, which makes it perfect to say. And now it was just someone who refused, even though we spoke English. He refused to talk it and just said, I don't understand, even though he did, to the language that was being asked of him. I'm going to really annoy... It's going to annoy me until I remember what this was.
It was a player.
Remember. It was a player. It was 100% a player. And he was from the Dota 2 scene.
ROTK? Wasn't he?
I'm actually even questioning right now if he was even Chinese, which makes us even less... Of a relevant story to talk about during the pause.
I just remember that ROTK thing where he did a lot of interviews where he didn't talk at all English, and I was like, personally, I was sure he couldn't talk any word of English. Like, he was just speaking Chinese and he needed a translator and everything. And then there was this, I think it was EMS or when Vici Gaming won EMS, and back then he was playing with Vici Gaming, and suddenly during the finals. Or he, during the interview in Chinese, he was like, thanks for my fans, thanks to my fan for supporting me. Like, what? What did he just say? You know, like, is it him? And, you assume he wouldn't speak English, and you probably said stuff around him. I mean, not on him, but like, casually talk about strategies or whatever. He's around, he doesn't speak English, right? And then that guy suddenly speaks English, and you were like, very confusing.
I remember that event, because we were casting it together.
Yeah, we were.
That was when we went to Poland and we went into this, this old warehouse.
Old factory, yeah. I don't know what it was.
An old factory, and it looked really, It actually looked really kind of cool and very European kind of thing. I'm like, I'm kind of liking this.
There was a stove
called Bruno. It was an oven thing, and everyone would just come and put their asses near Bruno. It was perfect, and all of a sudden you felt warm on the inside.
It was very special. Be there, I don't know.
It was a special moment with Bruno.
Yeah.
But Bruno didn't turn up to that one. That was that was back when production value could be okay, and you'd still we had two corners to work with for that production value. That was our casting desk, as well as Zoe and Malk were doing the interview corner.
Yeah, I can recall that.
Yeah. And it was bloody cold.
It was super cold in Poland. It was in Poland, right? Yeah, it was, I think. What?
Yeah, that was Poland. That was Poland.
Yeah.
But it wasn't like Katowice. It was
some O-name.
Yeah, it was A-W. Somewhere else. And I remember when to actually get to the event, we had to drive
20 forever.
Minutes from the hotel we were staying at. And then we went down this back road. We weren't quite sure exactly where
through
we should
forest,
be.
Through the forest even, right?
Yes, yeah, it was like through a forest and down through a road. Like in the middle of like what should have been like an industrial zone was this. Like it was also like a restaurant / entertainment club thing that it was being hosted in. Like there was even I don't know if you were in the car with us that time around, but there was a flasher as we were going in. So I was in there with a couple of players and Zoe and Malk. And like we're just like driving in. It was like that road coming into the event, and there's a bunch of trees. Like, oh, is that a guy peeing on it? And then he just turns and the coat opens up, and we're like, our morning has kicked off very, very nicely.
I actually missed that.
That was classic.
That was
one of the first times when I really saw snow, so I was happy as ever. I was freezing, but I was happy.
How's that? You haven't seen it or what? What do you mean it was the first time?
No, well, it was one of the very first times I was in Europe. Well, it wasn't the very first.
Oh, that's nice then. That's really nice.
It was like during the first year, and in Berlin you don't get real snow.
You don't?
No, not really.
Oh, they're back up. No, they imposed actually.
You get
snow,
but it's not thick enough. Yeah, we're started now, so we're good.
That was quite fast.
Yeah.
Okay,
well,
so
story time has to end. We get to focus on Dota again.
Yeah, which is good. No, I was just checking those off lanes. They're not getting so much. I think Arrow 2K is getting a bit more. Yeah.
It's a paralyzing cast can spin.
Gonna survive.
I think they're realizing he's only got tangos, there's no salve. So he's gotta slowly regenerate on the top, which gives a lot more space for Lunan to work. And Luo is forced to be defensive.
He has Bristle back, level 1, so it's like they can't really kill him.
He can't really do anything against them though, because he doesn't have quill spray or anything.
No. And for once we see Ferrari not crushing the mid lane first level, so that's already something. Inflame is getting the better trade.
Maybe that was also the reason too why he ended up picking up Templar Assassin. Mm-hmm. With refraction and side blades.
Yeah, definitely. There weren't any other reasons for the Templar pick. It was definitely a counter pick from Ferrari.
Well, Luo's dead. Sure. This should be first blood. It's like another Juggernaut spin and a malediction paralyzing cast. Through the work.
Yeah.
He ended up dying almost next to his own secret shop.
Yeah, that was a good kill. A really nice kill. They get the first blood on Juggernaut as well. That's good. He's already richer than what he was last game. 2 minutes in. Nah, I'm kidding. But I mean, he's gonna get a better game.
I don't think you're kidding. I think that's exactly correct.
At least he's gonna get a better game. That's good for him.
Notice too what Lanham is doing. He just came down and put an observer ward, looking to block up the ancient pull. So they're making sure there's no
commitment.
Stacking for Luo, so there's no recovery mechanism after he started the first
that's
time.
That's good. He's like, we got him. He died. We're getting good levels, so we're gonna get that safe lane under complete control. Also because the silencer actually came there as well. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's a nice move. I don't know if it's a bit of a shame they use the ward though, but whatever. No, it's good.
I think
good.
He had to commit
really
the
good.
Time to it. This is also because silencer, like DDC, he had a small little tussle with Faith, like it was more like a roll in the hay kind of thing. Around the ancients, because Faith moved off in the middle lane so we could do that.
Yeah, it already paid off, like they already stacked once and it didn't stack. So good. Yep. And they even see the Dazzle moving, I think. That's what gives a bit of vision. It's okay. It's okay. It's good from Lenham. No, he's gonna go mid. They're gonna get the kill on DSF. If he's not, yeah, they're definitely gonna kill.
Paralyzing cast. Where's it gonna bounce? Is it gonna come back? Okay, there's no bounce, but with the strike of the malediction, it's not enough to get the kill.
No, they won't.
Because he's got tangos and bottle charges available, so he's fine.
Never mind. But okay, he has his bottle coming back for the TA. Yeah, he's having a decent lane. 15-6 against 16-2. I mean, SF is farming. TA is not dominating, but at least he's not losing the lane as hard as he was losing the two other matchups. So, yeah, that's decent. ROTK is getting a lot on bottom now that the supports.
He's having a lot taken away from him. But he's got 16 deniers on this lane in under 4 minutes.
Yeah. What I mean is that ROTK, he's been able to sit on the lane from minute 0 to now. So he has... Actually, only level
DDC's
3 because Burning denied everything.
He's in a lot of trouble. That's a haste room for the Dazzle. DDC, the only choice he had was to try and deny himself to the Alpha Wolves. But he wasn't going to make it in time because of the Poison Touch.
So it's good that Bristol didn't get the kill. It's good for them that Bristol didn't get the kill though. But yeah, nice haste. Those runes, checking. It can turn in their favor. ROTK now getting a few CS. He got 3 CS, 4 CS. That's
huge.
Nice.
Huge.
They didn't stack. Oh, they stacked the jungle once, actually. Yeah, I think they could have focused on stacking a bit more with the supports. But I mean, as long as Bat can stay bottom lane, then those stacks aren't so crucial.
Well, what's going to be happening now? Like Lanham disappeared off that top lane for a little bit. That's when DDC moved up. So they spent more of their time for these EHOME supports rotating than really stacking.
Yeah, the control of the safe lane from EHOME hasn't been the best this game. I mean, Bristol somehow got to level 4 and he fed the first blood to the Juggernaut. Juggernaut got face boots and then Silencer moved from mid to top, and this is when Bristol actually XP'd. So it's a bit weird in my opinion. But yeah, it's okay. He can die to their lane now if he's not careful. They don't have the lane ward as well, so that's one of the problems with dropping the entrance. Like, he's now pulling. Like, there are 3 there and he just pulls and get the lane back to him to get some free XP. That shouldn't happen, but I mean, you can't really predict what he's gonna do when you don't have a ward.
Yeah, you have the vision. ROTK on the bottom lane is gonna go down. Went to the Firefly, Lanham with Malediction burning, he has to split, but this means they're gonna find a secondary kill. Lanham, he only came to help and he'll end up being collateral.
Yeah.
3-1 is now on the board. Is he home list too?
Yeah, scary place to be in for the Witch Doctor. I mean, the TP was definitely not needed, but it's those situations in Dota, it's hard. It's usually on the core to call. Like, maybe ROTK was like, they're diving, and then Lanham has to port to be fast, but you know, it's better if your core is like TP or don't TP. If he can assess the situation for you, because obviously you don't have time to click, assess, and TP. Your TP is always going to be late if you go for that.
Well, here's the run now on top of Luo, and Juggernaut, he got
die.
Close enough for the Omni Slash.
Nice play.
Yep.
Very well played from the Juggernaut. Good job.
It's really
that's
been quite good from this safe lane. They know when they can find these pickoffs. That's the second time now they've managed to find one. Just how far they can push it against someone like Bristleback, who is just so tanky by nature.
Yep.
Goodbye,
they're doing
Bata.
A good job. Control again, yeah, he died again. And now Lion is getting a lot of XP. Look at Sean. How did he die? Sean is level 5.5, so that was a solo kill, right? That's
no,
a big mistake
he had
from
help, but Burning moved up as well.
Oh, okay.
In fact, I believe Burning must have committed a clap or something.
I mean, Lion is almost level 6, so that's huge for Shroan. And Shroan is the kind of player that he's gonna utilize that level 6 fair, like, well enough. SF is rushing the Buckler? Okay, he went for the Buckler first. That's the first time I see this.
Well,
usually you wanna get 4
treads. Why do you prefer the headdress instead, or are you just meaning because you're not having the treads?
Yeah. The treads, I think, to be able to last it a bit better against the TA, but maybe he just wants the armor in case they go for him, which is fine.
Maybe he's worried
it's
about
of
like
armor.
The effective melt. Like,
yeah.
How much do you repair with the mech?
You completely negate it. It's like with the blocker, get 5 armor and melt is -4, so it's good. Actually, it's a good pickup. I didn't think about it. Nice one. He's gonna get a triple stack. He's gonna go for mech again. We expected this. It's a pushing lineup from IG. And Inflame is doing well, actually. He has 15 last denies, I mean. He's doing better than Ferrari. He's not crushing him, but he got a bit of... oh, okay, Faith is in trouble. No, he failed the traps, unfortunately.
Yeah. Even with the phase boots coming up, cooldown, but Faith to get back in range of the tower in time. Yeah. Faith has just attempted again to try and stack up the Ancients. He's wasted quite a large amount of time for this.
Yeah, the Juggernaut is having a good game. The Witch Doctor is a bit underleveled. I'm looking at EHOME's side, I think. The lanes are okay, but not so good for EHOME. Oh, that's a four-man smoke. Okay, that's interesting.
They actually brought in Burning from the bottom lane, as well as Ferrari. So they're looking to heavily contest the jungle. I don't know if they're searching for the Batrider before he gets the Blink Dagger. But at the same time, RTK's got Jack all.
Oh,
they're only
going
to find Lana. And Chuan. Well, if he can get the stun, well, he's going to start with a Hex.
Oh, the Tranquil
Boots. There's your stun, and then one Raise and a little bit of a Drain.
There's a lot of support from EHOME. That's going to be... They have the split, though. They can fight this.
That's a nice curse. Ah, Faith, that's not burning as much as I thought it was going to. Now, EHOME. Well, there is that Juggernaut ultimate burning. Going to split himself up, turn around for the fight. And that's going to be the Finger of Death to kill off the Juggernaut. Double kill in for the Shadow Fiend. Well, actually being the Death from the Finger of Death. They get the stun, Templar Assassin winding up the Requiem. He is being protected. The RTK, however, being controlled up. He just sat there. There's a triple kill in there for Ferrari. And maybe now he can finally die. The Shallow Grave keeps him up. The Silence has also dropped, so his four heroes going the way here of IG. Gonna make it even more. Inflame wants to run away from this one. They do at least kill off the SF. So with a cool spray starting up in flame, this is the worst position he can be in because the stacks are going to keep going there. He can stay in biz for a while, but...
One more.
Where is it? There's the mana. Oh, he needs another one.
Yeah.
He's close enough. He's in range.
You got him.
That's going to be the kill. And 10 now to 4 in favor of Invictus Gaming.
That's the strength of the teamfight power from IG early on. It's very scary, but honestly, huge misplay by the Juggernaut. I mean... I don't know what he was thinking. I think going for the fight is already a mistake from EHOME, but then the Juggernaut just went in. He forced the split, which is okay, but then he just ate that stun from the Earth Panda without spinning, and it's quite easy to spin on that one, right? I mean, you see it flying to you when it's not an instant stun, but he didn't spin, and then he got fingered, and then he just died. So yeah, a bit of a mistake from... ZYF, and then it turned really bad for EHOME. So.
It almost felt like EHOME thought they had global silence or something along those lines.
Yeah, exactly.
To take that kind of fight.
Yeah, but I don't know what they were thinking.
Was nowhere near that point.
Yeah, that's just a call mistake. I think they went for the fight where they really shouldn't.
Well, it's going to cost them pretty heavily. The net worth now pushes over 3k, and experience is also roughly
just
shy of 3k.
They also got the stacks. I mean, it was only a dual stack, but still, they negated a lot of farm from the Batrider. Look at ROTK. I mean, he's very, very poor, and he's not gonna get his dagger anytime soon.
Ferrari's got mech, Bunny's got blink.
Yeah, this is troublesome. Even the Bristol got a kill and got a bit of farm. All of this, he got a bottle, power treads. He's doing okay for himself, and now they started to stack Ancients.
They're going... Wait, is this Roshan or is this something else?
I hope it is. I think they should snipe Tosh.
They didn't get the Juggernaut inside the smoke, so they have to use three players to go around the back in the smoke to catch out Burning. But Burning's got
split
off cooldown.
I don't like this. They're going to TP with
SF. Shallow Graves, even if you're going to Omni Slash this one, Faith's going to Shallow Grave himself. Burning blinked down. He did get silenced up, but they don't have enough control. So Burning, he gets split off. Dazzle does die. Support's coming in from the Brewster back. And where's your control? They used it on the Juggernaut. He's already used his Omni Slash. Templar Assassin might be thrown up towards the air. ROTK now getting Nasal Goo'd all over. The Templar Assassin again forced to thrown up towards the air. ROTK, he still wants to stay in this fight. Luo is just quill spraying him up. He has to keep his distance. Chuan with the Finger of Death. That's not enough damage to kill up the Templar Assassin. Dropping him low, this healing ward, maximum duration, but the Juggernaut, he's out of life and out of time. Or is he the Flame Break? Pushing him back far enough, the Cool Spray, it doesn't reach up to him, but you're on 5 hero retreat.
Front's
on cooldown, that's why Burning couldn't get the initial slow, but with a spin away, it looks like EHOME will get out of here with only losing the Witch Doctor, and Luo is out of mana. Ferrari's not looking much better with the Lasso from RTK. Luo forced back under the tower, the Melon Strike working, but Burning blinked into the clap, slowing down RTK to Ferrari. Number one race, that Weave is going to remove all the armor here from EHOME and buff up IG. In fact, are they going deeper? Yep, Burning, YOLO, underneath the tower, and he gets the crit! He actually got the Drunken Brawler, so he better pick off DDC and potentially get back out of here in time. The Malediction is on top of him with a Shallow Grave. There's not enough mana for it. He's short, but the mech charge is already up here for Ferrari. They'll take out the Tier 2 tower as the fight will come to an end. things, wheels, off the rails for EHOME. I had cheer given so much.
Radiant structures I mean, you can tell with that fight how stronger IG's draft is. At least at fighting, early on. Like, there's nothing EHOME can do. This draft is terrifying. It's so strong. They just dove forever. They kept on going and they can't be punished. The EHOME can't even burst the hero down. Like, there's not, they have no damage early on. They need the Witch Doctor ult. They need Juggernaut to be super farmed, and he's not super farmed. They need global, and I don't even think global is such a big deal this game, because they're
just so
tanky. I think
global could be a big deal at the start. Because for me, exactly. I feel the major problem that went wrong there was the fact that Shallow Grave tanked up the entire Juggernaut ultimate. So the Omni Slash, I know it's still only level 1, but he used all of that on him, which means while Burning was being silenced up by the rest of EHOME, the Juggernaut wasn't inflicting the damage, which means Burning got the split off, EHOME got controlled long enough that IG could bring in every bit of the cavalry over the hill.
Yeah, it was huge for them, for sure. No, Global is gonna help, for sure. I just think it's not gonna turn the fights in EHOME's favor, but they need. I think right now they just need to farm. They need the Blink on the bat, they need the Juggernaut to be farmed, they need TA to get something. I mean, they picked TA as a counter pick, but this is when IG is gonna gather S5 and take down towers and get Roche. I think getting Roche, you said it during the draft and I agree, I think getting Roche early is really important for EHOME's lineup. At least if that was the plan, and then the plan is viable. But if it's not the plan, then I don't know what the plan was. And I can't think of any plan that could work. Now it's too late, now they're gonna go into Roche and there's nothing they can do. Without the bad dagger, if they go there, they're just gonna give up kills.
Yeah.
So, I don't know, if I'm EHOME right now, I'm very, very scared. I think it's IG, if they played it correctly, they can win this game. Like, it's very hard for EHOME to do anything right now. They need to keep on farming.
Yeah,
it's all they have to do. Keep on farming and defend base. They have global and bad trader. It's a good base defense.
Well, if they can keep that up, if they can just keep avoiding IG, apart from this moment where DDC is going to get hexed as well. There is no more stun, so technically DDC could attempt a TP out, and then Burning arrives and, Well, yeah, it wasn't worth it anymore.
Poor guy, he tried to get the global, get some XP, but he is not there yet, but he's going to get it by the next push for sure. I mean, look at the tankiness. They have mech, they have Vlad, they have a Vanguard on the Bristol soon. If he wants to go for this, or no, he went for the Ogre, never mind. Ogre Club, they have a Dazzle, it's... How do you kill them? Like, you just can't kill anyone, honestly. Right. There's no one you can kill.
The only thing you can hope to do is probably kite them.
Like, yeah, exactly.
The only way you can do that is by having already, like, two sticky napalm charges on almost all of IG when the fight begins. Your TA traps in the perfect position, and you use Lanham the way he was in game number one. You had that death ward that was able to make IG really scared about running in underneath the EHOME team fight.
The problem is that with that mech and Vlad now, they have a lot of physical, like a lot of armor with mech and Vlad. So that death ward is not going to do as much work as it did in game one. And what they need right now is they need Blink 4 staff. The major item in this game is to get the 4 staff on the Bat Rider. That's what they need. What they need to do is when base defense, they grab someone, they pull him back behind the towers, they global so they can save him, and that guy just dies.
Sure.
And then,
nice
done. So,
follow up Hex, gonna go onto the Juggernaut, Respect needs more time to do the damage. And Chuan doesn't want to commit the Finger of Death, but with Burning coming in from behind,
nice,
he's looking for Lanham, they're gonna get the kill, so Brustleback Cool Spray that ended up
nice
doing the work.
Though.
And now it looks like a 5-man down mid, because they took the tier 1 tower. EHOME were attempting to trade for the tier 1 tower in mid, but
it
that's the reason
TP.
Why IG just left SF up there to do the job.
Yeah, it was a nice try from the Juggernaut, but now they're gonna go for base. And I don't know. Let's see how EHOME approaches that. I would be very, very scared if I was EHOME here.
Yeah.
I wouldn't see many options. But let's see. They might have something up their sleeve. I'm looking forward to it.
Right now, I think the only thing up their sleeve is only going to be exposed once this happens. IG go high ground. EHOME have to come back.
Courier.
Inflame's going to finish the... where is that courier going? It's bringing in
I
a couple
have no idea.
Of...
The TP for OTK. Now they know the battery is behind, so look at the positioning. Schwan instantly goes left, but they see the Juggernaut as well.
Where's this jump? There's your global silence. They're dragging Luo in as deep as they possibly can with the curse as well. There goes your Juggernaut ultimate, but as you're saying before, where is this damage going to come? The Weave is already starting its effect, and the mech charge went, so Lanham's going to drop Dead's Finger of Death to ensure there is not going to be any kind of real death ward effectiveness in this game, in this fight for EHOME. But it's still ING forcing high ground. The Brewmaster ult is going to wear off now. So Inflame can try and turn and fight. They did lose their tier 3 tower. And the Aegis fall on the back of Ferrari. Maybe there is enough comms to keep fighting this one. ROTK, Flame Break needs more space. It's not going to get it. Templar Assassin cannot intimidate IG in any way, shape, or form here.
They used everything they had to use. They used Lasso, they used Global, they used Omni Slash, Death Ward. And they removed 500 HP on the Crucible. Well, that's what happened.
Yeah.
I mean, this is a heavy alt pick, honestly. We said it during the draft. They got alt picked again. In game 2, it was a heavy alt pick, in game 3 as well. And they could, if they play that, you can always win in Dota. It doesn't matter. I mean, draft is very important, but you can win with any pick. If you play it right, you need to understand what's at stake, and I mean, what are your weaknesses and your strengths. And going for that fight in the jungle, when they had nothing to fight and lose 5 heroes, definitely put them in a really troublesome situation. And I mean, I don't know. I think they played it wrong. But maybe they can still come back when they wait for next Roche. If IG doesn't have Roche, it's a bit scary, but look, even the Bristle, like, they even go for the Bristle back. I don't know, they need to burst the Panda somehow, but then you have the Tassel. It's very hard, honestly.
Yeah.
It's very, very hard.
Like, maybe if you had yourself, like, a second Silence or someone that was more focused, like a Lion instead of the Witch Doctor, or Lina instead of the Witch Doctor, then... You could say there was some hope, but right now the only chance EHOME has really got is the ability to blink Lasso, isolate one hero, and just nuke him as quickly as you possibly can. That's the only way that's going to happen. You've got to commit both Omni Slash, Meld Strike, Curses, Malediction, the whole shebang to pick off one person, and this is the person. It's Luo on bottom lane. So now, Lasso, Malediction, or everything. Okay, they've got enough. That was actually without Omni Slash they found that kill. But at the same time, they just lost their Templar Assassin in mid, so... Yeah.
It's a good kill. I mean, they got 1k 400 gold for this. It's nice. The Juggernaut has 3k 5 gold now. Maybe they can hold. I mean, but even if the Bristle dies, like, the problem still remains. Look at those four guys. Like, you can't even push them back.
Yeah.
They have Global. They don't have TA.
They don't
I like that
this.
TA when it goes for Deso.
They can't fight this. Their Weave is halfway through his duration. They got plus 12 armor on this Brewmaster. Global Silence will happen, but where is your damage going to come? Malediction is nice. Follow-up Death Ward here from Lanham, but Burning splits up, gets the first one over on top of Lanham. Templar Assassin did buy back with the Requiem of Souls plus the Finger of Death. Chorn's the one to pick up the double kill here. Inflame to then be controlled up by Burning inside that Brewmaster ulti, and that's GG. 20 minutes is all it takes on the clock. For ING to put the final nail in the coffin, and we have our final three teams for the D2CL China. It will be VG Gaming, who is sitting in the grand final. They'll play up against the winner of teams 2 and 3, and that is now LGD, as well as Invictus Gaming. That's the first game tomorrow starting at 10 CEST. Should be a cracker.
I think it's fair to say that the three best Chinese teams are the three teams that remain in this qualifier, to be honest. But yeah, it was... Great games from EHOME as well. EHOME played really well game 1. I don't think they played so bad game 2, game 3. It's not about this. I think they got outpicked game 2 and game 3. Like, or at least the way they played their draft made it look like it, as if they had no options. So yeah, very very solid draft and rotations and very very solid game plan from IG. It was quite impressive. Game 3 and game 2 were quite impressive.
I'm just happy we had game 1. For me, I feel that at least bought everybody their wonderful entertainment ticket for today.
Yeah, game 1 was really nice.
Yeah, there's more to come as well as far as entertainment from joinDOTA. We're not done tonight. In fact, we have a couple of our MLG live streams coming up, so check it out at joinDOTA.com. Flipside going up against Vega, and 4AFC going up against Stranger. Is what I have on my list here. There's also the ESL1 matches, so that'll be right on the ESL1 Twitch channel, and that's when ATN takes up Tinker, so the ESL1 qualifiers do continue tonight. Check out joinDOTA.com for all the details. You can follow Sebastian as well over at Bucking Mad Dota, that's with a 7. If you just look at the title of the live stream, his Twitter's in that one, or right here on Dota TV, it's also there. You can also follow me at Toby1Dota, Twitter, Facebook, all that kind of jazz, and I have a Twitch channel! Which has now subscribers, so if you want to support me in all wonderful ways, go to twitch.tv/Toby1. Just Toby1. It's no Dota, no nothing. It's just just Toby one, and I'll be doing some casual streams. I've got Assassin's Creed planned later on this week, so if you want to join me for that one, follow the channel, and I'll get to see you over there. And of course, follow Sebastian, Alliance. I believe you guys actually have some games tonight. You have a game in 5 hours.
Yeah, we have a game versus Secret in 5 hours, so it's going to be a good test for us. We've been doing decent lately, so yeah, it's good games. Yeah. Let's keep on like winning. Let's try to protect that winning streak.
Let's keep winning. Let's keep this whole idea that I am the savior of Alliance. That's the point.
I'm really glad to be able to play with players that are as talented and skilled. So it's really good. It's a very nice experience, and hopefully we can keep this thing going.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to seeing it, man. So so D2CL continues tonight. Make sure you check it out, and we'll see you all back here for that live stream. In the meantime, go check out JD for the next stream link, and we'll see you next time for the D2CL.